Just a quick reminder that Ham Radio Now is viewer supported. If you like what we do and you want to help keep us going, stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. Click on our mascot here, Arvin the little piggy bank, and you've got two options. You can do a single contribution, or you can now subscribe for a monthly contribution. That would be cool, but we don't expect it. You can pick the amount that you want. We're aiming for that $10 a year from 10,000 hams. We're a long way from that. And you can type in some comments in your call sign, anything you want to tell us. When you click the add to cart, it takes you to a PayPal site, but you can pay with a PayPal account or with a credit card just by checking out. So any way that you want to do it. And thank you very much. On with the show. Ham Radio Now from Orlando. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
And I'm Greg Jurrens, K5 Golf Juliet.
From Flex Radio Systems. Thank you for coming by, Greg.
No problem. Thanks
for
having me
over. We did not invite you for a sales pitch.
That's right.
Although I'm sure that a little bit of pitchiness will...
Well, it's like when I give my talk on, you know, the software-defined radio technology. It's impossible to talk about SDR and not at least mention Flex Radio. You know, we're celebrating our 10th year this year. We sort of started this whole SDR concept.
We're celebrating our first year this year.
Awesome.
Anniversary.
We began last year at Orlando.
That's right. You guys came by. As I recall, it was a slightly different setup, but you've really grown. Everything looks great.
You can see that on episode... What episode,
episode
was that?
Episode 2 is where the interview was.
Oh, okay.
That's great.
Okay. But episode 1 is... Here is where it all began.
Yeah, episode 1 was our tour. So, and you've noticed you haven't seen a tour here, so go back to episode 1. The Hamfest looks pretty much the same. But what we want to do here and spend some time at it is start from something very basic and work our way up to probably something not very technical, but moderately technical about what this software-defined radio thing is all about.
Sure.
Because I'm sure we have a wide variety of hams at different levels of understanding of the technology. Most hams will want to know what it can do for them, which at that point becomes a laundry list of features. But they'll also be curious about what happens behind the hood to some extent for how you can do all those features and why things work the way they do. Now, at the current state of technology, and probably receivers are where people pay the most attention.
Absolutely.
Software-defined radios... And radios that use DSP but are not software-defined, they're still pretty much in the analog domain for most of their work, are almost neck and neck. But you guys are pulling ahead. Have I got that right?
I would, from a technological standpoint, I think that's absolutely true. And actually, I talk about the so what when I give these talks. And it's because software-defined radio is cool, but the cool won't get you another cue. You know, you won't be able to pull somebody out of the noise. So what happens is, if you take, in the beginning there was the you know, super heterodyne multi-conversion radio. All radio started out that way. It's actually, the super het came before the direct conversion receiver, interestingly enough, by a few years. And so the super heterodyne is real simple. You bring the RF signal in, you mix it in a local, you mix it with a local oscillator down to another frequency or up to another frequency.
The basic technology there is when you put two frequencies into a mixer, you get two more frequencies out.
Yes, you do.
The addition and the subtraction.
That's correct.
And that is such a basic principle in radio that still, it's not much in our exams, especially the tech exam. So the idea of mixing is so fundamental, I wanted to at least cover it in its essential.
Right. So actually, that is the theory, and then comes the reality. And it's great, because if we could build a perfect mixer, the need for software-defined radios would be less.
Yep. And the reason we do that mixing is lots of different frequencies come into the front end of our radio.
That's correct.
However wide we want that radio to cover. It is not, even in analog, not the least bit efficient to try to work with all those frequencies. You want to work with one frequency and do your filtering, most of your filtering and most of your processing with just one frequency. The intermediate frequency is what it's called.
Right.
I'm showing an amazing technical ability that no one knew I had.
Well, Gary, so here's where things get broken, is that when you mix in those the frequency you desire and the local oscillator that you have, unfortunately, all those other frequencies that you don't want are also come screaming into that mixer. And the mixer is also not perfect. So you get A plus B, A minus B, and all these other little frequencies that come trundling along with it.
There's a lot of crap coming into the to the things where you want to really just work on one frequency.
And that
our PA system has gone off. Let me really close you in on that microphone.
Okay. So what happens then is you end up with distortion. It's intermodulation distortion, and you don't, you know, you don't need to know the math, but what you do need to know is that all those little sub-frequencies and all those little mixers that happen in the reality side of the mixer end up as noise in your headphones. That noise is going to block you from hearing the signal that you want, especially down at the bottom.
And it's not noise that you would identify and say, ah, I'm hearing mixing
That's correct.
Garbage. It's just... Psh.
That's correct. It will sound like distortion. It ends up, believe it or not, it ends up as fatigue in your headphones. And so after a few hours of, say, chasing DX or contesting or just talking on the radio, if you've ever had that desire to rip your headphones off and throw it down, that's that fatigue that you're talking about.
And that's mostly from the guy never answers me.
Oh, well, okay, there's that too.
And we're mostly talking about weak signals.
Yes,
if you're,
really.
If we're hearing S9 signals all the time,
you won't see it. But if you... You know, if you're trying to chase that last bottom of the noise, some of that noise is, you know, how do I get rid of it? So what you said earlier, you filter. Well, now for the bad news. A few years ago, we sort of reinvented this concept of the roofing filter. And we all rushed out and we bought roofing filters for our existing radios for the IF frequency.
And define a roofing filter.
A roofing filter is nothing more than a bandpass filter that limits the bandwidth of the intermediate frequency, this IF. And so, theoretically, again, that would only pass the IF bandwidth that you're interested in, blocking all of the other interferer signals, even the louder ones, thereby creating a roof or a cap on the signal that you want. So what you would want to do then, theoretically...
Well, so the width of those filters is, for single sideband, 2.7 kilohertz and maybe a 1.8 kilohertz.
It
How
actually,
narrow can you get them?
It actually turns out that what you would want for roofing filters is about double. So, for instance...
So this isn't your total selectivity.
Right.
It's just, it's your first chance to whack off the stuff you don't want to hear.
So imagine a 3 to 6 kilohertz sideband roofing filter and maybe a 1 kilohertz or 2 kilohertz wide CW filter in the IF stage.
Okay, so now, there's going to be more filtering after that.
Yes, there will be. Down in the next stage. So again, I'm going to slap you in the face with reality. Reality says I can't build a perfect filter because it's got components in it. I wish I could. So now what happens is the filters themselves actually create more intermodulation distortion. They become a million little tiny mixers.
And you're driving me back to wanting a crystal radio.
Why, guess what? Even crystals have mechanical oscillations in them, and they also create all this distortion. So what happens is you've got all this distortion added and added and added. And so a roofing filter is great for taking care of the big signals. It's what you would want to do. But at the bottom of the at the bottom of the noise floor, it's adding to the problem.
With one hand you giveth.
Yes.
And the other you taketh away.
There is no free lunch in a hardware-based radio. And that's just the downside. So what happened was...
Well, there's no free lunch in a software radio either.
No, there's
not. We'll find
out
about that.
There isn't. That's correct. And so what we did about 10 years ago is we created a direct conversion receiver, just like your crystal set, with only one mix that came from RF. You mix it down to a baseband audio level. So that's really an IF. And it really is a mixer. So that means it has non-perfect... And we create distortion. But the good news is there's only one physical mixer and only one physical local oscillator in there.
So when you say it's a baseband audio level,
right.
It is another set of frequencies. You changed your RF frequency from the frequency you're tuned into on the dial to another frequency, much, much lower. But when you say audio, we think of audio as ideally 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz.
Right.
But you're above that. You're broader than that.
Yeah, for instance, on our existing Flex 5000 radio, we run audio at 190 kilohertz wide. So we actually do our digital sampling, your analog to digital conversion, using effectively a super high performance sound card, if you will. And we do that at 192,000 samples per second. And that's where we digitize that signal. So once again...
Okay, so you've done one analog mix in the 5,000 and before series of Flex radios, because we've got, you know, the 6,000 is something
right.
new.
We'll get there.
Jeff, are you following this?
Yeah, so far so good.
Yeah.
Carry on. So,
feel free to ask questions.
Yeah. So the deal, Jeff, is that you know, that one mix gave us amazing dynamic range, less noise, less distortion. Not perfect, but a quantum leap over what was out there available. And so that's the reason that the 5,000, the 3,000, the 1,500 have always been at the chart, you know, at the high end of the chart for all the receivers. It's not rocket science. I wish we could say we were brilliant engineers. Well, we're good engineers. But the reality is there's less noise. There's less distortion. There's less things to mix, less things to go wrong.
Because you've only done that one analog transition.
That's right.
And in that 192 kilohertz sampling, you have opened up a window of RF, 192 kilohertz wide.
That's right.
That you can now play with.
You end up with a thing called a pan adapter, which basically is a visual representation of this frequency. And so you can see signals now. When we first started, we used to talk about see it, click it, work it. And the idea is you can see the signal on the band, tune to it, click on it, and then you can hear it and you're there. And so it adds another dimension to the receiver.
Well, analog radios have had pan adapter capability for a long, long time.
Yes, they have.
And they do that by tapping a signal out of the intermediate frequency before the filtering.
Right.
And they can see a certain width, but usually wide as all the ham bands, and maybe wider.
Right, right.
So is there an advantage to what you're able to see in your pan adapter?
On the existing, the Flex 5000 and earlier radios, there is some advantage in some cases, and some are about the same. It turns out that you can add a pan adapter if you've got the ability to get a good IF out. Some of the more modern hardware-based radios and DSP-based radios actually do have an IF output in the 9 megahertz range, and then they do a single conversion down and use a very similar approach to what we are. As a matter of fact, a lot of folks use our PowerSDR software with their converter to pull the IF in, and that's fine. We wrote it 10 years ago. It's always been open source. We encouraged the industry to grow, and it did exactly that. We were able to create an industry of software-defined reception, software-defined radios around that for the ham market. By the way, hams did not invent, well, there were probably hams that did invent software-defined radio.
But they were being paid by some big faceless corporation.
That's correct, or some contractor,
yeah.
Right. But what we did was we brought that into the ham space. So it's real interesting. I guess I want to go back to that mixer, that one mixer.
Yeah, we need to get back on track.
Because if taking out all but one mixer was good, what would it be like if we could take them all out?
Well, let me ask a few questions What went on after you did your digital sampling. Still at the 5,000 and before level, and mm-hmm. I guess the soft rocks and
yes, right. The LP pans, yeah. The soft rocks, everybody that did what's called a quadrature sampling decoder.
Yeah.
Right.
You now have a digital signal. Well, you can't put a digital signal into your speaker, so you got to do some stuff with it.
Right.
What? I'm not sure how complex and how technical we can get, but let's give it a try.
Sure.
And you're going to go over my head quickly, over Jeff's head in a little bit.
No problem.
So what happens digitally? Now, this is all where the software engineers get their cooks into things.
That's right. Well, let's take the baseband, this audio stream, that what we're going to do is we're going to do an analog to digital conversion. And interestingly enough, we're actually going to sample the audio, or the baseband, if you will, twice. And this is where it's a little complex, but it turns out that mathematically, if you sample it in phase and then 90 degrees out of phase, that allows the math to become very much simpler to be able to do processing on it. And without getting too deep into it, what you want to do is you want to work on audio in the time domain. As we sit here,
you keep saying audio, but it is not speaker audio.
Right.
It is low frequency stuff compared to the RF.
It's a low frequency representation of the RF. Thank you very much. I say audio because we kind of think of it that way.
Yeah.
But you want to be able, but the spoken word and CW and things like that are really time based. You know, as time goes on, we sit here and talk right now. You could count 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and there's time. Correct. It turns out that what you want to see on the screen is not time-based, but frequency-based. So effectively, we need to not work just in the time domain, or not work just in the frequency domain. We want to be able to work on both of them at the same time. So this creation of this in-phase and what's called quadrature, I and Q signals, it's not all that important. But once you get it split into these two signals, it makes it very easy mathematically to work on both the frequency and the time domain.
Okay, so this was two totally separate independent samples being taken of the RF that's been converted down to baseband.
But they are synchronously happening at the same time, and that's
really
important.
Yeah, I shouldn't
really
say it's quite
important.
So independent.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Yeah, but one is, it keeps things in phase, and one is shifted. It's got to be delayed because you can't go into
the future.
Yeah,
it shifted 90 degrees, happens to be, if anybody cares.
Yeah.
So once you get these two streams,
and that's that I and Q. I keep hearing I and Q, and I was going, what do they mean, I and
yeah.
Q? Okay, so that's where the I and Q comes
that's
from.
That's exactly right. So once you have these two streams of bits, of numbers, if you will, going in, then what? So what? We're back to the so what can you do for me? Well, now I still need to filter out all the junk that I want. And the way you do that is you start using digital filters then.
And that's a variety of junk. It is RF signals that really appear on the band, that are really there, that
that's
you need
correct.
To narrow things down on.
Right.
It is the junk that came out of your one mixer stage.
Yes.
And all the permutations of stuff that occur because we are dealing with radio that doesn't belong or is there, but we don't want to hear.
Correct. It's noise that can be coherent. For instance, it could be the 60 hertz buzz of the fluorescent lights in your shack. It could be your power line. It could be the 35 kilohertz every so long that's coming out of your Ethernet spigot. We call that coherent noise. It's noise that you can describe and go, yeah, I know where that's coming from. If you can repeat it and see it, it becomes coherent, something you can repeat. Well, if you can repeat it and see it, you can take it out. You can filter that in digital using digital signal processing.
And can anything like that happen in analog?
Yes.
Well, there's been noise blankers.
There's been noise blankers, and there's been noise reduction, and so there are analog equivalents.
And they have their own limitations and distortions.
Absolutely. Right. You run into the same kind of distortions and things like that over time. The harder ones are actually the non-coherent noise, that broadband grunge that's coming out of the arcing transformer across the street from your house. Those are the much more challenging noise sources that are hard to take. And frankly, in the digital domain, they're just as hard to take out in the digital domain as they are on the analog side.
Well, can you take them out analog?
You can do
some. You got a million bucks to spend?
Yeah, if you have a lot of money, you can do it. And I'll be honest with you, we've been partially successful in the digital domain doing it. And by the way, any kind of software-defined or even DSP-based radio, at this point in the process where you've kind of got it in this sort of, it's not radio and it's not audio, this is where you do all this filtering. It takes horsepower. It's all about horsepower. If you had a Cray X1 running, you could handle it. And so, you know, if you've heard me talk about our new radios, we joke about the fact that it's got all these gigaflops. You know, we have a radio now that has 191 billion floating point instruction capability and another 317 billion multiply and accumulate DSP cycles.
There should be a red sales pitch.
I know.
Sign flashing.
I get it. The okay, problem it's okay. is it's the message to say yep. that it takes that kind of horsepower to knock these signals down. And that's what we discovered. That's when we ran out of gas on the Flex 5000 was yep. we couldn't do it anymore.
I want to stay at the 5,000 level.
Absolutely.
And then
that's
the, and
sure.
the 192 kilohertz width and all
yeah,
that stuff
sure,
for a little while longer. The software that is now doing the filtering and then making the conversion back to analog,
mm-hmm.
not to mention the software that gives you your graphical user interface.
Right.
Show you how to push the buttons and make these things happen. that's where things start to get distinguished between one SDR manufacturer and another.
Yes.
You all figure out different ways to do this. There's more than one way to handle this. Software gets written by different software engineers.
Absolutely.
Some is more successful than others, but it becomes a, you know, a competitive race at that point doing that.
That's absolutely right. You, and I will tell you that we're both honored and pleasure, you know, proud of the fact that the PowerSDR software, which is the basis of many of the programs that are out there today, was something that our team developed and then, you know, gave out into the industry to kind of get things going. So there's a core inside, the digital signal processing core, that many people use the same core. Now, what you stick on the outside in the pictures and you dress that pig up, so to speak, that's really based on taste and style and things like that. But at the core, most of it's running the same code.
So PowerSDR was not just a graphical user interface. It
No.
was the SDR, the stuff that was taking in that 192 kilohertz. So PowerSDR was the program that tore it apart, did the filtering, and spit it out into your headphones.
That, absolutely.
Or onto your screen for a digital display.
All the heavy lifting for the digital signal processing and the audio and the wave shaping and noise floor and your equalizers and your left and right. And, of course, on the transmit side, it all works in the modulation and your ALC and everything, every knob and dial that you touch that's audio.
That laundry list of features.
Correct. That's all happening in software, in the case on PowerSDR, in your PC. If people say, well, I got to get a dodecahedron 9000 PC to run all this stuff. Well, you do need a decent power processor because there's a lot of stuff going
yep.
on.
And that starts to transition us into what you've done with the 6000 series. Because with the 5000, you got from your little box, mm-hmm. The little black box FlexRadio, you got the 192 kilohertz stuff coming out.
Right.
Did you go back into that box and tell it to do more stuff, or is everything now happening inside the computer?
Based on the Flex 5000 and back, it's once you get the INQ stream out of it, you say, we'll take it from here, and everything else is done in the PC up until the point you ship a digital or you ship audio back to the radio so you can play it out in the headphones. So it's digital. All the heavy lifting's done in the PC, and the last thing that's done is to drive the audio amplifier for your headphones.
Okay. And that left you, to some extent, at the mercy of your user base and their individual PCs and how they were configured and what they were going into. That is a nightmare scenario for a manufacturer.
Yeah, we sell half a radio. I mean, that's, you know, this sounds terrible, but that's effectively what happens is we sell half a radio, and then we hope you buy the other half, the good half.
Yeah, and you tell people what they needed.
Absolutely. We do our very best.
And good hams listened,
yep.
and some hams didn't. And your service phone line probably was pretty busy with folks who didn't meet the specs still expected it to work.
Our customer support folks are heroes. They are, you know, Dudley and Tim and Klaus and everybody. They do an amazing job. And virtually, well, not all of it, not 100%, but the vast majority of our problems and issues relate to people that are having PC-related issues.
Yep. And if somebody out there is watching this and saying, well, I called Flex, and I know all my stuff was good, and their stuff was still crap, and it didn't work. There were times when they did everything right, and it still didn't work, and you worked through it.
Of course. Yes, that's absolutely true. And, you know, every once in a while you ship out a radio. Hey, you ship thousands and thousands of radios. Something's going to break once in a while, and it does happen, and we feel bad, and we get them in as fast as we can, and we fix them and ship them right back out. That happens. You know, stuff occurs.
Yep. So you're at the mercy, to some extent, of your users' PCs.
Right.
And that probably was not an ideal situation for you.
Not perfect. Yeah. Right.
In addition to wanting to be able to do more than could ever be done in the user's PC.
Right.
We are now going to talk about the 6000, and this changes the game.
It really does, because we ran into the same challenges that all of our esteemed hardware-based radios. Even though we were able to take all but one mixer out and get rid of most of the noise, we still had the challenges of having to cope with the PC that's external. Also, even in the most perfect of PC lines, you still have to transmit that stream of data from the radio to your computer or whatever it is that you're going to do this filtering processing on.
And even though that's been getting faster and faster all the time, there was USB, USB 2, Ethernet, USB 3, FireWire, everything
right.
gets faster and faster. Not every PC has the fastest input capability.
As a matter of fact, with the advent of the iThing, you know, pads and those sort of mobile devices, PCs are actually getting slower. PCs are getting less expensive. Classic PCs, unless you've got a desktop, you know, the laptops today are very stripped down, very minimalist type computers. So those high-speed interfaces are actually getting less and less, believe it or not.
And my guess is that you didn't want to be more and more rigid in what you were telling people they had to have for a PC.
Yes. Yeah, the challenge is the list of available PCs with, say, FireWire built right in is getting lower and lower. Even Ethernet and USB and serial ports and things like that are getting less and less. And I didn't want to get down to actually having to specify brand names and model numbers.
And they'd change anyway.
Almost on a monthly basis, that's
yeah.
correct.
They're out of your control.
Absolutely.
So when we were talking to you at Dayton, and Jeff was doing the interview at Dayton, I'm sitting there on the headphones and I'm going, oh, they're pulling the processing into their box. Oh. Now, I have a little more background than probably most hams do in what that does for you. Not that I have the technology behind me very much. It's just that I have been inundated with the Tapper conferences mm-hmm. and the HPSDR guys and,
right.
and their Mercury and Excelsior, you know, all the stuff with the Greek god names until they ran out of those and started using Disney names. and the things that they were doing. And a couple years ago when Phil Harmon of VK4APH talked about designing the Mercury receiver, I'm going, oh, my God. Antenna, filter, A to D converter.
Absolutely.
Whoa. And he described all kinds of contortions that he had to go through. He said if he could make every receiver for $100,000, this would be easy.
That's
right.
But
if he wanted to make them for $1,000 or $500, he had to do some things. Everything he described about what he did, I didn't understand. But I got the concept that he did them. And I'm going, listening to you talk at Dayton and saying, you're doing it. You're doing that.
That's exactly
on
right.
On a manufacturing level, not just a tinkerer level.
Right. The folks at HPSDR did a really cool thing in that they took the software-defined radio concept and then they expanded it to a thing called direct sampling. And here's the key. Direct sampling does that last thing that takes out the last mixer. Imagine taking an antenna and shoving it right into a chip and digitizing it from RF to bits without a mixer. There's some advantages and there's some challenges. The advantages are it's the very best dynamic range. It's the very best in terms of feature capability.
Now, and that's going to be somewhat dependent on that chip that's doing the A to D conversion.
Well,
you've got to have
course,
a good chip
that,
there.
There's that theory versus reality thing, and that's exactly right.
And that's one of the things Phil was fighting. He
yes.
had to get something he could afford to put in.
Correct. It turns out that not in the ham space, but in other places, we've been doing direct sampling receivers for the Department of Defense for almost 5 years now. But the
so you know what the sources are, you know what the technology is that you can work with,
right.
and the costs.
Right, but the price tag was just prohibitive in the ham space, and we knew that. We joked about the fact that if we could just build a radio for under $10,000, then we might have a market here in the ham space. And so we've been waiting patiently and quietly and watching the technology improve, and meanwhile been doing it, you know, in improving our skill and our craft with other markets, but just waiting for it to come. Because the only downside, literally the only downside to a direct sampling receiver is it's technologically challenging to do. And oh, by the way, it's financially expensive.
Yeah.
It's just, these are amazing pieces of silicon and they're expensive.
So evidently they have come down enough, or you have learned to use the cheapest ones you could get and make it work.
Right.
Did you go through the same contortions that Phil had to?
Absolutely. Yeah.
I remember the term decimation. And
correct.
You know, he's talking about how he slices one filter and, okay, that helped here, but it hurt there.
That's exactly right. I am not that guy, by the way. I don't even play that guy on TV. But we have those people working for us, and they do amazing things. Briefly, what happens is you grab the data in, and for instance, in our radio, we sample at 245 million samples a second. Okay, so you've got these 245 million 64-bit wide words that you've got to do something with.
And we're comparing that to 196,000.
Correct.
Now to how many million?
We've gone from 0.2 million to 250 million.
In one fell swoop.
In one jump, right. And so now what we're doing is we're effectively swallowing the entire HF spectrum at one time. Now the cool thing is I can do I wish it was infinite, but we can do N receivers out of that one capture. Okay. We can do N pan adapters.
And that is adding now to that laundry list of things you can do that now we need three sleeves to show it as you went right up in that arm.
Correct.
Before we talk about that, discuss the things that show up on our end of the
so what?
Yeah.
Right.
It's all new software.
From the ground up.
Yeah.
As
that stuff comes in, it now has to be processed. And so the chip is now inside your radio. You're not trying to shuttle that out to the user's PC.
Correct.
You're doing all the work in yours, and the user's PC is now purely the control panel.
It's the human interface device. You're watching a movie, and you're listening to a stream of audio. That's correct.
And the user's control panel can now be a much, much, much simpler, cheaper PC.
Absolutely. I have a little quick...
Or a little pad.
I've got a YouTube video that I put up this last week that shows me running it on the cheapest netbook I could possibly find. It's got if you're into Passmarks, the average PC these days has about 5,000 Passmarks. This thing has a 400 Passmark. And it was running it just fine.
The best part is we're running this wireless over the LAN here in the office and not having any problem talking to the Flex 6700.
Because it's like watching a movie. If your widget will run a YouTube video, it can display smart SDRs, pan adapter screens now.
Yeah. I remember from Phil's talk, he had talked about the INQ, and he said that the INQ is necessary after the single conversion, but it created lots of problems of its own. And so your conversion at the very widest end of RF, no, there's no more INQ.
Right? I will say yes and no. And this is, again, where I am not skilled in this art. There is both the frequency domain and the time domain data, but we operate it in a different form. We crush the data down. You mentioned decimation. The way I describe it is squashing. You squash the data down. You know, 245 million samples a second takes about 600 million floating point math instructions per second to process. That's a lot of data. And so you've got to have all this down. So you can't deal with it raw. You have to squash it down into what's useful.
And we're used to the concept of compression in all kinds of digital stuff.
Mm-hmm.
MP3s are highly compressed audio, but they still sound great.
Yes, they do.
The high definition video that we're putting on the internet is nowhere near the total data rate that these cameras are recording. Stuff is being thrown away and sliced off like crazy. And still the picture looks pretty good.
That's right.
So you're doing the same thing inside the Flex Radio. It's throwing away a lot of stuff.
It's called a lossy conversion for a reason. It's a lossy conversion. We're throwing away things that are not interesting. However, there's some other cool things you can do with that data. So there are some lossless things. And I'm not I don't want to get into too much of that detail, but there are things you can do that are lossless and things that you can do that are lossy. And you do them both at the same time. All it takes is huge horsepower.
So that's what you put into the 6000 series.
That's correct.
And these are not processors like we have in our, not Intel processors like the Pentiums and stuff.
They're not.
Special purpose processors.
That's correct. We have actually two different families of processors. One of them is what you and I might know as a processor. As a matter of fact, It's a dual, not a dual core, but it actually has twin, if you want to look them up, they're called ARM processors. So it has a pair of ARM processors plus classic digital signal processing on one chip. And we have this other thing that the best way I can describe, it's called a field programmable gate array. And the way I like to describe that is, imagine reconfigurable hardware. It's so it operates at hardware speed, but you can reconfigure it and reprogram it on the fly. And that's how we're getting the performance throughput. We're actually literally wiring up custom processors for one job, and then tearing that down and wiring up another custom processor
that,
for
that
another
distinction,
job.
That distinction may be something that, at least some folks in the audience don't understand very well. Although you've been exposed to it a lot in people talking about trying to accomplish stuff on computers. Hardware typically works faster than software.
Yes.
If you want to do something in software, you got some overhead in terms of time. If you want to do something in hardware, you've got overhead in terms of stuff you've got to put in.
Yes,
and most of it, special purpose stuff that's only going to do one job, and if you want to change the job, you can. So this FPGA is a chip that bridges that hardware-software divide.
That is correct. That's exactly. And frankly, we couldn't build this radio without field-programmable gate arrays.
And that's the same thing that the HPSDR guys are using.
Absolutely.
Maybe not the same chips, but the same direction.
Yeah, ours is about a generation or two newer, and you know, quantum leap in terms of speed, but the concept is exactly the same.
All right. So now you've got this these special purpose processors in your radio. How do they compare? Is there a comparison to high-end PCs in terms of capability? Are they ahead, behind?
Oh yeah,
they're doing what you need to do.
Right, because we can make them do custom things. They're really a couple of orders of magnitude faster, and because we can. If I trained you to do one job on an assembly line.
And that you could never do that.
Well, I understand. I agree.
Not trainable.
Untrainable, yes. But if you could do just one job, Jeff, it would be one of those things where you could do that job over and over again. You would get better at it. You'd get much better at it.
You would.
Jeff would.
And so what happens there is you want to do that. It's the same thing with field programmable gate arrays. We teach little sections of that chip to do one thing very fast, but just that one thing. So it's not a general purpose processor, but a custom one. And then we can reconfigure it, tear it down, and make it do something else.
Jeff, have you ever played with any things like that?
No, I never have. Much more sophisticated than anything I've ever done.
Suddenly for your work, you're going to start looking into them. See if there's something could be done with them.
Well, where I work, probably not. But it would be interesting to work with.
All right, so your software engineers wrote software, once again, that tears apart this now massive signal into pieces that can be dealt with and processed into the stuff that is going to come forward to us. Is there anything in between that you want to talk about a little bit that makes sense to discuss so that we understand how this works? I'm in between the 250 megahertz and the...
I'd actually just... probably say that's where most people are going to innovate, and we believe that's where the industry is going to grow, because we can put in what we call our intellectual property, our knowledge, our smarts. It allows us to personalize, so we move back up the chain a little bit. I mean, think about it. Your classic Icokin Yewood radios, you know, in other words, all the hardware-based radios that we've all owned for so long. Their innovation, their personalized radio, is in how they do filtering or how they do buttons or how they do displays. Well, now we can add that personalized intellectual property from FlexRadio in this hardware, this sort of soft hardware area, and really get performance out of it that's just, you know, unthinkable. It was unthinkable even a few years ago. And so probably I'm not going to talk a lot about what's inside there, what pops out the other side.
Yeah.
For instance, in the case of our Flex Series radios, we've got a radio that actually can do up to 8 receivers on 8 different bands simultaneously. And oh, by the way, we're not talking about audio width or even 192 kilohertz, but we can display 12 megahertz of bandwidth on the screen per band at the same time.
Yep, and those are all very cool things I want to get to very quickly. But before we talk about that, the one thing that everybody is going to want to know, mm-hmm. I don't care how many receivers you've got, how good are those receivers?
I'm going to give you my I now, because we've been playing with real radios for a couple months, I can now give you some real world experience. There's theory and there's practice. Theoretically, they're amazing. Theoretically, they are limited only by what's called the phase noise, the noise that the radio themselves generate. Practically, you know, you've got antennas, you've got the environment, you've got that nasty transformer across the street. So I wasn't really sure just how much it was going to be better. Last week, I was working, just listening to some 10-meter beacons down in Argentina, Costa Rica, places like that. And they were 2, 3, 4, 5 dB out of the noise on the new Flex radios, the 6000s. I flipped over to the Flex 5000. I couldn't
same
even
antenna.
See it. Same antenna, same everything. Just flipped AB. Couldn't see them, couldn't hear them. They just weren't there.
You just pissed off a lot of Flex 5000
I know. Believe me, I'm one of them. I own a Flex 5000. And so it's one of those deals, like, I'm amazed at how much this phase noise dynamic range, this concept of, you know, we've done all this work to get to the top. Now we're working to get rid of the noise at the bottom.
Are the 6000s on the market? Are people buying them now?
People are placing orders. As a matter of fact, I have a huge backlog. It's one of those big problems. When am I going to get my radio?
Yeah.
We will begin shipping in April. So the people that ordered early are going to get them sooner. If you were to place an order today, it's going to be July.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's so, good information. Okay. But where I was getting at was, we will hear from users once they are in the field and everybody's using them.
Right. There are people in the field using them and testing them now, but they're all under what we call non-disclosure. We don't want to get
We're talking about the folks that have nothing other than their love of Flex, which you've got a lot of people that have that.
Right.
But if you give them a product they're not happy with, you're going to hear from them. We're all going to hear from them. They'll be all over YouTube and everywhere saying, hey, they sent us crap. So you are expecting, if you've seen that yourself, you are expecting a reaction from the troops once they've got the radios of the same thing. They are going to go, whoa.
Yes. Yes. And I had that whoa moment, and I was told to expect it, and I frankly didn't believe it, I guess.
Yeah.
It really is that way. I was shocked. And so I'm expecting all of our thousands of customers, you know, to have the same reaction.
Right. From my dispassionate pundit, semi-curmudgeon point of view, it's like, all right, we'll see.
Yeah, no,
we'll
you should be skeptical. I agree. I was, and I think you should be too, and I expect everyone else to be.
More realistically, we'll see how much this puts you maybe ahead of all the competition, and we'll see where the competition reacts. And, I mean, it's going to be a race. No one is going to take advances like this lying down.
No. So, I would fully expect the only thing it will be fun to watch is that it took so much technological skill on our team. And I mean, we had to grow our team. We had to triple the size of our development team to pull this radio off. And so it's not going to be for the faint of heart in terms of, you know, if somebody just showing up and saying, hey, I want to try one of these things. I mean, there's, for instance, there's one part that has 1,300 pins on it. And, you know, just
you solder them individually. Amazing.
No. Matter of fact, it takes real skill and ovens and everything else just to put those chips down on the board. Okay. So this is very technologically advanced stuff.
Yeah, it's both software and hardware design that has gotten very advanced.
Right.
This is also not a $1,200 radio. Or even a $3,000 radio.
No, it is not. I will tell you, though, that we have been able to squeak out a radio that is very comparable to our existing Flex 5000 in terms of cost. That'll support, actually, it'll give you double the number of receivers. So it'll give you four receivers at once with a built-in antenna tuner and the 100 watts and everything else for a bit over $4,000, which is right around where the Flex 5000 and the other top of the Sherwood list kind of receivers.
So that's the base of your 6000 series?
Yes, it's the 6500.
And then it goes up from there.
Right, and we currently have another unit that actually has up to two spectral capture units, the two antenna connections at the same time, and it actually does up to eight receivers simultaneously. And it's more expensive.
Let's look at that laundry list. Start talking about your favorite stuff that you think hams are going to really drool over.
Visually, the ability to see what bands are open at the same time is very cool. One of the guys took one home this weekend, and he's using it for CQ WPX. And he sent me this screenshot of him watching for 10 meters to open. And you could see 20 meters and 17 and 15 and everything else, but 10's not open. So he knows not to go there as a contester. On the other hand, imagine you're chasing some DX and he's working eight bands or something like that. You could literally line up eight pan adapters, eight receivers, and listen to him on every band, waiting for the propagation to open up. And so that's what the so what is going to happen. The other thing is, with the real-time high-definition pan adapter, you can literally see the spectral content of a person's voice. It's happening so fast. I was over in the booth earlier this morning copying beacons visually. You know, it's so loud in here because of the show, but it was running, 15 or 20 words per minute, and the pan adapter runs so fast, I can copy visually the call signs. Now, I sure wouldn't want to copy a QSO that way, but I can copy a beacon doing that.
So this is those multiple pan adapters on different bands. Now, in order to use that effectively, you sort of have to distribute among antennas that are somewhat efficient on those bands you're listening to.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And
haven't figured out how to digitize an antenna yet.
Not yet. But what we have discovered is it's time to dust off, in addition to your cool stack of monobanders that you own, it's time to dust off that G5RV or the pixel loop antenna or a hex beam. As a matter of fact, we've been experimenting with several antenna manufacturers have been sending us antennas to try with the broadband. And the good news is that even with a classic monobander, you can see a lot of spectrum. It's just not optimized in that space.
So what you see on your extra receiver may not, you'll see it. You'll know that when you put your multi-tower, multi-element array
right.
pointed at it, it's going to get bigger.
Absolutely.
But at least you had a chance to know it
right.
was there.
Because the receiver's so sensitive, even if you lose 20 or 30 dB of attenuation because it's not in the band of desired, it works really well. We've been surprised at how well it's working there.
All right. And you're getting feedback from your beta testers.
Right, exactly. Yes, we're getting screenshots and pictures and wow reports and things like that. And, of course, the usual amount of bugs and, hey, I did this and this happened and I did this. And that's what beta testing, that's where we are in that cycle now.
So you got another couple of wowzers?
What's coming next?
Well, no, the current set of features in the radio, that's multiple receivers, is, I think, probably the killer app.
Yeah.
But what else is in there that is just extra cool?
Oh, gosh. You're putting me on the spot now.
Okay, so that is head and shoulders above everything else.
Yeah. I'm just trying to think of the neatest stuff. Actually, in addition to having multiple bands, it's kind of neat to have multiple receive windows or multiple slices on the same band, especially if you're looking for somebody on DX.
So you can narrow things down.
Well, not only that, I can be literally listening to two or three stations at once, and you might say to yourself, oh my gosh, I can't do that with audio. Well, it turns out that if you've got a decent mixer, and of course the software, that's easy to do, an audio mixer, you can put the guy you want in your left ear, and you can put everybody else in your right ear, or you can solo type of things.
Yeah, I've discovered that with, because I got multiple radios going off all the time, and especially in my car,
right.
Some spatial diversity helps. Some
yes.
volume diversity helps.
Absolutely.
And I can even understand the lower volume separated from the higher volume if I want to concentrate on it.
Right.
So there's a variety of ways to do multiple right. receivers.
You mentioned WOW, and I think the last thing to mention is the concept of, because this is an Ethernet-connected radio, that's a real radio server, if you will. More than one person can log into that radio.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking of.
Yeah.
This is internet connected.
The connectivity is just amazing. Now, here comes the caveat. I will tell you, with the first release of SmartSDR, it will be local area network only. And that's because as we went through the development process, and actually the HPSDR guys, gave us some good data along with some of our non-ham customers. Internet security is a big deal. I'm going to adjust these. There we go. Sorry.
Yeah,
I was about to
no problem.
Go like Mickey Mouse there. Internet security is a big deal. And we need to spend the time to make sure that it's secure, because I don't want my call sign getting hacked. So we've got another cycle planned into our development to go to wide area networking. But when we get there, imagine being able to drive across town or across the country and play radio. Or imagine me here in Austin, Texas, wanting to be able to listen but your radio is halfway across the country and I'm trying to work a net and I need a fill. Well, that fill, if you will, could be logging into your receiver and listening. So I can work an entire nationwide net just using multiple receivers across the country. So that network connectivity is a very cool idea.
And that network connectivity gives you remote control two-way, right?
It's absolutely.
Not just
yeah.
receivers.
Yes, that's
so
right.
Do you have applications that for the iPads, Androids, things like that? Are those available or coming?
Not yet. I will tell you this. One of the things that challenged us with the Flex 5000 and back was that we were almost arbitrarily limited to Windows-based processors or Windows-based software because of some chips, some stuff inside the processor and some decisions architecturally. We designed this radio from the ground up to be OS agnostic. So we expect your iThing and your Android thing and your non-Windows applications to be available. And they'll come in time, and they may not all come from us either.
I was going to say, is this something that only you could develop, or do you have, what do they call those, APIs?
We do have an applications programming interface, an API, and we are working on a developer program. We're not ready to roll that out yet, but I will tell you, hang on, we're getting there. It's just, you know, it's on our laundry list of things to do, where we'll be partnering with some folks. And we also want to make the innovation. Remember, part of the tenet of amateur radio is to expand the state of the radio art. And that includes software as well. So we want to work with the individual contributors and the companies that develop commercial ham software.
The 6000 series is going to be for pretty doggone serious hams.
Yeah. Yeah, this is probably...
Based on starting with price and then starting with features, we don't expect every ham to want 12 receivers displayed across their shack, necessarily.
Not to begin with.
There's going to be... yeah, it's true. There's going to be plenty of hams that... And you know, hams like me, to begin with, that looking at my 756 Pro 3 sitting on the shelf...
Yep, it's great
that
radio.
That does what I'm looking for in ham radio right now.
Mm-hmm.
Although I look at your stuff and I go, like I say, I keep going, wow. But I'm probably not going to buy one next year. But
right.
You've got a market. You have people that will be buying this. And I think you were describing what your pre-sales were like.
Right, right. We, you know, we're a privately held company, so I really won't talk about details. But one of my favorite things to say is, you know, when we rolled this out and announced it, we were expecting a few people maybe to throw in and place a pre-order. I mean, we had hundreds of people coming to us the very first day that we began to take orders for this. There is a pent-up demand for this next generation because if you know the technology, you know what a deal, you know what a game changer it really is. So there is, yeah, it's the higher end hams. That's not a good word to say. The folks that have a more sophisticated station and they want to take advantage of this type of technology. But there's plenty of people out there to do it. And the best part is, as time marches on and the technology gets more affordable and we get better at doing what we're doing, it really does give us a vision of the future of where we think all of amateur radio is going.
Yep. A quick question. This is a total subject in itself, but a question I've asked a few of the folks that are especially on the edge of being able to do this, looking into the future. Audience is getting really tired of me drum beating on digital voice, as particularly digital voice on HF.
Right.
But with a software-defined radio, my things about digital voice on HF are that it's got to be built into the radio if anybody's going to be using it. You got to have a button, a digital button. And in fact, I shouldn't say digital voice, I should say data stream. Mm-hmm. And because voice is only one part of it, and bandwidth and voice and whatever else you can cram into it become issues that all become interchangeable. I think a data stream, including voice and other stuff, is going to be a very important part of ham radio in the future at some indeterminate point.
We totally agree.
And is there a digital data stream button? Can I get my call sign embedded in the software somewhere that Gary gave you the name data stream, a DS button?
We are. I'm going to smile and say that we designed a radio platform that doesn't really care. So if you want to talk classic sideband or CW, or we have a ton of customers who are AMers, and we want to be able to generate the very best synchronous AM in the world. Well, guess what? That's just software. And so a digital data stream with digital voice or digital embedded voice and data, that's just software.
Okay, not coming in 1.0. Because there's not very many people out there using it. But, I mean, even for you guys, you need a codec that you can use. And you're
that's
not going to spend $1 billion on a codec.
So
now there's codec 2.
Right. There's a code.
You know all about that.
An encoder decoder is called a codec. The encoder is what you speak to with your microphone. A decoder is what ends up getting played out on your speakers or your display or screen.
Thank you for reeling me back.
No problem. No problem. But codecs are just software. And in a software, it's where a software-defined radio shines. And since we've got the horsepower in the radio now where it belongs, building codecs as plug-in modules is the perfect marriage. And the other thing is, so what if you don't want it? Some people will, and those people will have the opportunity to be able to get the, you know, the codecs that they want. And so you'll be able to personalize your radio. It's funny, I hate to say this, but there'll be an app for that.
Yeah. The 5000 series, folks use the external, you know, Win DRM programs and stuff.
Absolutely.
Through virtual audio cables into their Flex 5000s.
Yes.
And that seemed a little disjointed to me.
You know, it works great when you get it there. It's a little clunky to set up. I'll be honest with you, our customer support guys spend a lot of time. 35% of our customer support time is spent helping folks interface third-party software. So I've got to work on that. We got too many customers now to do that. So we believe that bringing that inside the radio is going to help a lot. Now, I want to make sure everybody knows this is really important. We're not going to abandon your favorite logger, your favorite digital mode, your favorite everything else. We have to work with the legacy support. I mean, we call it legacy. This is great stuff, don't get me wrong. But to us, that now becomes sort of legacy support. And we've got a really good plan for supporting your favorite logger, your favorite voice keyer, your favorite digital mode program. But we're hoping that we can work with these same code developers to bring them into the all digital realm with us.
Okay, so stepping into the future.
Right.
I was talking to Eric over at Elecraft, and I had somewhere between a brain fart and an epiphany. We've seen the skimmers and the PSKs and the stuff putting a display across the screen of the data that's coming through.
Correct.
I am thinking someday when there are 10 or 15 simultaneous digital voice contacts at the same time. With digital voice, you've got the signal-to-noise ratio to be able to do a halfway decent voice recognition.
Yes.
A stream of conversations being displayed as text across your screen and saying, I want that guy, I want that guy, I want that guy. And they're on phone.
Right.
They're not on data, they're not on CW. They're digital, but they're on phone.
That's correct.
And now you're picking them out. Have you thought of that?
Yes.
Damn it.
Yes, we have. Sorry about that. it's a race.
I am no futurist.
It's now a race to figure out how quickly we can code it and start offering opportunities like that to folks. It's going to be great.
There was one last thing we needed to talk about.
Great.
That you had brought up before. You still need an antenna.
Yes. Oh, these are real radios, folks. You still need a real antenna.
At least an antenna.
You need a real power supply. You're going to need a real microphone to hook to these things. And real pair of headphones or speakers. They are real radios. This is classic radio. Even though you're sitting in the grocery store parking lot working that DX station, you're still talking to your station at home with your antenna at your QTH, and you still get to hang the QSL card on the wall. So it's real ham radio.
Thank you, Greg, for coming by. Jeff, is there anything you want to toss in here?
I don't know how much time we have left, but, you know, with something that is so software-centric, it's easy for the hardware to get kind of lost in the sauce. So it's probably been covered in numerous tutorials and so forth, but if I could just ask you a couple questions about the hardware.
Oh, sure.
So there's an antenna, and it's the same antenna we've always used. Might have a tuner, might not.
Probably
That's right. Terminates with coax, but wouldn't have to. That plugs into the box that you supply.
Yes.
Basically, what you supply is the hardware box and the software.
Right. We have it's an entire radio inside. It has amplifier, filters, antenna tuner, preamplifiers on the receive side, antenna connectors, multiple ones, connections for your amplifier, connections for your, you know, although now the smart amplifier, smart rotor controller, smart antennas can all be driven directly from the radio.
So it's basically the stuff that's on the back of a traditional radio with none of the buttons and knobs that are on the front.
That's correct.
Okay. Now, and your PC provides that functionality, right? The buttons and the knobs.
The PC is the human interface, yes.
Okay.
It's your control, we call it surface. Mm-hmm. It's a control surface where you touch or drive or mouse or wheel or whatever you use will go through your PC to the radio, and then your display comes back from the radio to the PC.
And then the interface between the radio and the PC, what's that protocol?
I'm sorry?
The connection between the radio and the PC.
Oh, we're using an Ethernet connection. It's actually a gigabit Ethernet, but it'll run at 100 megabit. So it's classic what you would use to connect your PC to your DSL or your cable modem.
Okay, and that brings all the control signals for the UI, but what about the audio from the microphone and to the speaker? Is that over the Ethernet as well? Or?
It's both. You talk to the radio, or you can go remotely. I will tell you, in the first release, it'll be radio-centric, but after that, you'll be able to send audio back and forth over the air, because you have to have that to remote.
Okay, so a ham wanting to make the jump from his old Kenwood to your Flex radio needs no modifications to his antenna system
at
all.
No.
Nor his power distribution or anything.
That's right.
He needs a PC that does Ethernet.
He'll need a PC, and it doesn't need to be a fast one, but it needs to have at least some graphics capability.
Okay, and then the front end, a microphone and headphones may not work.
And let's not forget our paddles. You know, one of the things people really wanted us to improve was QSK for doing full break-in keying. And by moving all that stuff back into from the PC to the radio, now we have full break-in keying on the transmit side.
Okay, so the 5,000 and below, the paddle plugs into the PC.
No, actually it plugs into the computer, or into the radio,
into
I'm sorry.
The radio. Okay.
But there's a little bit of what's called latency.
Right.
And that latency, if it gets too long, you'll hear it in your head. It'll make you crazy. So by taking that loop out, then the latency goes to virtually zero, and it's just like a hardware radio at that point.
Okay. All right, I think we got it.
In the middle of your development, Microsoft came out with Windows 8.
Right.
Is your software Windows 8 looking? If it's not now, it probably will be.
It actually already runs Windows 8, no problem. Actually, all of our PowerSDR does. Our latest version, 2.53, runs Windows 8 just fine. Now,
do you take advantage of touchscreen?
I was just about to say, in Windows 8's legacy mode, where you're touching like a mouse, it works perfectly. We have not gone to the point to exploit the Surface yet. Believe me, we've written everything to be compatible. The user interface we're using is compatible, but we have to make that jump as well.
One step at a time.
That's right. Right now, everybody that's got a radio on order, they just want us to get them out the door.
Indeed. The ham fest is collapsing around us.
That's right. They're tearing down booths around us.
You got to tear down your booth and make an airplane. So thank you very much.
No problem, Gary.
And
appreciate it.
We will
it.
See
Jeff,
you at
thanks.
The next
Greg,
ham
nice
fest.
Nice to see you again.
All right. And you can help us wrap up the podcast here. This is the way we do it. I'm Gary Pierce. Talking to that. Right. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
And I'm Greg Jurrens, K5GJ.
And we all say together, over and out.
Over and out.
And out.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
That
all right.
was amazing.
All right. Good.
Thanks. That went well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Hope we don't make you late for your airplane.
Yes.
Go right.
That way.
Okay.